Thanks to all of you that submitted your questions for this hashtag MLB Q&A. Nothing wrong with talking some baseball, even though the 2013 season is over. The city of Boston is rejoicing in yet another World Series championship. Man, never thought I'd say that in my lifetime. Yet another, as in three in the past decade. Hats off to the Red Sox. You suffered for a lot of years, your fan base, your city. I may not like you very much, but hey, I can empathize as a Cubs fan. I just want one before I die. Just one. Just one fucking World Series. That's all I ask for. Anyways, so I hope you guys enjoyed this Q&A. And again, thanks to all of you that did submit your questions. The next Q&A is going to be some Hall of Fame discussion. Hashtag FootballHOF. And that is going to be your chance to ask any questions about the Hall of Fame in professional football, whether that be people in the Hall of Fame comparing players of past versus present, who I think are the greatest players at certain positions, players in today's game, and whether or not I think they're Hall of Famers or not, and why or why not, who I think should be in the 2014 Hall of Fame class. All of these type of questions, anything and everything pertaining to the Pro Football Hall of Fame, that's the subject for the next Q&A. So go to my Twitter handle, at SchlegDaddyTV, and tweet your Pro Football Hall of Fame questions to me using the hashtag FootballHOF. Let's get started with this hashtag MLB Q&A, though. We are pro wrestling, asking the 100 years since the Cubs, it's actually, yeah, in the 100 plus years, that's 105 now, since the Cubs last won the World Series in 1908, which Cubs team had the best chance to break that streak? Now, popular opinion will probably be the 2003 Cubs team. That's definitely one. Popular opinion may be the 69 Cubs team that pissed it down their leg late in the year and made way for the Miracle Mets. I might say 84. You know, that's at the very beginning of my time when I was 3 years old. That was a team that had a tremendous chance to get to the World Series and maybe even beat the Detroit Tigers that year. But let's face it, frankly, you don't have as good of a chance in the NLCS as you do in the World Series. So I would go back to maybe 1945, 1932, stuff like that. There have only been a couple of teams, frankly, that had a good chance to end that streak. The most recent, obviously, being 2003, maybe the 84 team, I think, had a little bit of a better chance. But again, that was because of the dipshit fan base of the Cubs, of which I'm a part of, and their incessant love of that piece of crap, Wrigley Field, and for whatever reason, wanting to cling to whatever stupid tradition there is there, which is all losing tradition, pretty much, mind you. It's mostly bad memories of losing. Every time I ever went to a Cubs game, they always lost there. Why we hold this decrepit relic as some type of godsend to baseball and some historical monument, it's a dump that should be torn down, and it cost the 84 Cubs because they didn't have fucking lights there like every other damn ballpark in the world. And as a result, they had to play their last three games of the NLCS against the Padres, all in San Diego, even though the Cubs, in theory, had home field advantage. But, well, Wrigley is a great place, and even the current regime, they seem to be more fixated on renovating Wrigley than putting together a winning ball club. At Chris Cody 8, is Chipper Jones going to be a first ballot Hall of Famer, and does he deserve to be? Does he deserve to be a Hall of Famer? Yes. Does he deserve to be a first ballot Hall of Famer? No. To me, a first ballot Hall of Famer, in the way it has been done traditionally with baseball at least, whether I always agree with it or not is something else, first ballot induction should be for the truly special, the once-in-a-generation type of guys, not 260 hitting, one-trick pony defensive shortstops like Ozzie Smith. Hall of Famers, yes. First ballot, no. But, you know, the really special, iconic players deserve to be first ballot. You think of Chipper Jones as being a very good player for a number of years, a star player, but you don't think of him as one of the greatest of all time and the best of his generation. Is he going to be first ballot? I don't think he will be, but I do think he'll get in, and I'll be glad when he does get in. I always blame Bobby Cox for changing his positions halfway through his career because I think it cost him a little bit and hurt him. At Vulpin Milk, do you think Matt Harvey will return better or worse from his Tommy John surgery? Remains to be seen, but some recent history would suggest that, you know, if he misses most or all of 2014, he'll come back in 2015, and then 2016 he might be as good or better than he ever was. And also, what will it take for the Mets to contend? Time, patience, and building up that farm system and staying away from dumping a bunch of garbage-ass money into the free agent market on the people like in the past of the Johan Santanas, and the Jason Bays and Met fans, you know what I'm talking about. And obviously, Chris Cody, you're a Mets fan, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. Excuse me, Volpin Milk. You've got to be a Mets fan, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. At Alex Schmidt 316, what are your thoughts on the whole Steve Bartman situation? I think it's tragic. I think it's sad. I think the Cubs organization at some point in time needs to have a mea culpa, and they need to make good to Steve Bartman because, you know, it really ruined his life in a lot of ways. Even though he's still in the Chicago area, they need to bring him in. They need to have a Steve Bartman day, and I'm dead fucking serious. Have him throw out the first pitch. Have him sing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. They need to do all of that. They really do. I think it's tragic that idiots blamed a fan for a collapse in the eighth inning in that Game 6 of the 0-3 NLCS. The Cubs surrendered 8 runs in the eighth inning. He didn't sit there and mentally implode like Mark Pryor did. He didn't sit there and botch the easy double play ball like Alex Gonzalez did. There were so many other factors, and not to mention the fact with Steve Bartman, they still had a Game 7 at one point in time that they led 6-5 after Kerry Wood's 3-run homer. I'm tired of people bringing up Steve Bartman, and I'm tired of people blaming Steve Bartman. If you think Steve Bartman had anything to do with that loss at all and that implosion in that series, then you're fucking stupid. How about not finishing business in Game 5 down in Florida and letting Beckett dominate your ass? All this other shit. I'm so pissed off 10 years later that people still blame Steve Bartman. It's ridiculous. At Fork 34, do you think Ken Griffey Jr., my man, could have been the greatest player of all time if the injuries never happened? There definitely was a chance. I think it's tragic that Griffey, as great as he was, and this is an example to me of a first ballot Hall of Famer, no question. The first 10 years of his career did it all on its own. The kid, I mean, that was my guy growing up. You know, some people had Bonds. My guy was Ken Griffey Jr. And do I think if he would have stayed healthy that he could have went down as the greatest player of all time? Yes, because he was a Gold Glove center fielder. He could hit for some average. He could steal some bases. And he was a prodigious power hitter with that beautiful smooth swing. Oh, my God. Played a masterful center field. You know, he was a guy that you looked at, you thought was going to be able to hit 800, 850 home runs without the stigma of steroids. It's just tragic what happened to Ken Griffey Jr. What could have been. And I say that, and he's a Hall of Famer. Not only a Hall of Famer, but a first ballot Hall of Famer. But you still look at it, and you're like, what could have been? What could have been? How crazy is that? That's how good the kid was. That's how good Ken Griffey Jr. was. That's how big of a star he was. Think about how big of a star he became when he was playing all those years in Seattle of all goddamn places. Think about that. At Anthony_Rizzuti, which player, manager, and GM would you want to start a franchise with right now? Player, I guess it depends on your philosophy. You know, obviously you couldn't go wrong if you built your franchise around Clayton Kershaw. I might say somebody like a Mike Trout. You know, guys like that, because I'd want somebody that's young that still could get better and has lots of years left in the tank. So that would make me avoid somebody like a Miguel Cabrera, who's still not that old, but he's not the youngest chicken in the coop anymore. As far as manager, I'm not really sure, frankly. I'm really not all that sure. I'm just being honest. Maybe somebody like a Mike Matheny? Maybe? No, not a Mike Matheny. Yeah, I don't really know. As far as general manager, I'd go with Andrew Friedman of the Tampa Bay Rays. Because I think in baseball, you have to build up and develop your farm system, and the Tampa Bay Rays consistently over the years have been able to do that. They crank out prospect after prospect after prospect. That's a guy that I'd want running my organization, especially my farm system. At Best Buy Rick 1, do you think MLB will ever make the DH standard in both leagues? No. For some reason, Major League Baseball, the owners, the commissioner's office, everybody involved, they're always so slow moving to adapt to any change that is necessary. They need to make it uniform. Either both leagues have the DH or neither league has it. The fact that one does and one does it is not cool. It's stupid. It always has been and it always will be. But I don't really envision them ever really changing it. They're just going to keep it the way it is. Also, do you think Sammy Sosa should still get into the Hall of Fame even though he took PEDs? I do. And the reason I do is because you're going to tell me that in an era where most everybody was doing it, most everybody was cheating, that you're going to basically wipe out an entire generation out of the history books. You're going to keep an entire generation, for the most part, minus a few players, out of the Hall of Fame. Sammy Sosa is one of those guys that you cannot tell the story of Major League Baseball without talking about Samuel Peralta Sosa. And that's a bottom line. Him and McGuire in 98 were instrumental in really bringing people back to Major League Baseball a few years after the strike of 94 ended the World Series. That type of impact cannot be understated or underestimated. He was a star. He was a franchise player. I think the Cubs organization, and frankly a lot of Cubs fans, forget just how good Sammy Sosa was and just how much Sammy Sosa meant to that organization. What have they really done since Sammy Sosa left? So, yes, the guys like the Sosas and the Bonzes and those types, at some point in time, I think you got to put them in, because otherwise, if you don't, you're just basically eliminating an entire generation, and then you're opening up that can of worms of how do you know this guy was cheating? How do you know this guy wasn't cheating in the past? Do you really want to go there? Maybe you make them wait sometime. Maybe you wait till the graybeards. I don't know, but Sosa's got to get in, and I'll fight and argue for that. At Dynasty 215, do you think Ryan Sandberg can take the Phillies back to the playoffs, or I love this name, or ruined, or has ruined Tomorrow Jr. killed the team as general manager? Ruined Tomorrow Jr. I think Sandberg could get him back to the playoffs at some point in time. I'm not sure if it'll be in 2014. Did ruined Tomorrow Jr. really kill the team as a general manager? Look, you had a window of opportunity. You had guys like Howard and Utley and the Victorinos and the Jimmy Rollinses and the so-ons and the so-forths, the Cole Hamels. You had to plunk a lot of money into that team when you did, because you had a window of opportunity to win, and you got a World Series championship out of it. So what is there to really complain about? Yeah, unfortunately, you're dealing with some of the consequences of that now, but you got your World Series. Be thankful for that. Trust me, I have no idea what it feels like to root for a World Series champion. At least you do. And I think Sandberg could get him back to the playoffs, but maybe in 2015. @_ruckfools_. Do you think the MLB needs to update some of their tired habits to appeal more to the younger demographic? Yes. Too numerous to name. There are a lot of things they could do to appeal to younger demographics. I think more so than just the tired habits. But some of the tired habits, yes. You know, they could do things to speed the game up, make it more interesting. They could do away with some of these stupid-ass fucking unwritten rules. There are a lot of things they could do. And do you think Yasiel Puig should have been an All-Star? Yes, I really do. Baseball, I think, needed him at the All-Star game. And, of course, Major League Baseball does what Major League Baseball does. And they failed to find a way to get him into the All-Star game. Bud Selig. That's it. Bud Selig. I know you're going to say, well, the fans didn't vote him in or this or that. No, the bottom line is, fuck that. If I'm in Bud Selig's spot, you're putting this kid on the All-Star team somehow, some way. You don't like it, you can kiss my fucking ass. Period. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this Q&A. Like I said again, the next one is #FootballHOF, where you can tweet any and all questions pertaining to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. I look forward to that Q&A. I'll see you later.